Hello and welcome to this edition of Desert Island Movies. And you will see today I am not joined by one guest. Oh no, we have doubled up. We now have two guests. We have none other than Larry and Paul, who are pretty much considered the Anton Deck of political satire. So welcome to the podcast, guys. And how you doing?
We're very good, yeah. Yeah. Normally we get the Dick and Dom of political satire.
Well, so one half of that, anyway. Wow, the Anton Deck of political... we'll take that. That's the DVD.
Yeah, and do we win NTAs, like, year after year?
Win them forever, yeah. No one else. Yeah. In fact, they'll eventually name an award after you. So, that's how it goes. So, how are you doing, anyway? How have you been, boys?
Yeah, we're very good. We've been kept busy by this terrific government, or terrible government. We don't know how political you get, so there's an edit point for you.
Yeah.
So there's obviously plenty of material day in, day out for us to attempt to satirise.
And if you're watching this from the future, it's an interesting time that we live in.
Or the worst time ever, depending on your view.
Or maybe the apocalypse has happened and you're looking back on it now and this is what civilization was like.
This is all that survived.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You see us, Matt.
Government didn't, however.
Overlooking Leeds pre-apocalypse here, and we have our lovely TV show and your logo on the wall as well.
I'm loving it. Some product placement, that's what I like to see. Excellent. So you produced the real Downing Street briefing, so we'll get onto that shortly. Obviously you're here to talk about your films. Now we're doing things slightly different for this episode because obviously I have two guests, so three films just aren't going to cut it. So what we have agreed to do is Larry and Paul both get a film each, or two films each, and they're going to share one, and they've got a soundtrack each. So this episode will be slightly longer. However, the rules are still in place. They are not allowed to choose an entire film series as one pick, so you can't just go Star Wars and have all nine films. That's not happening. And also, you can't just pick sequels. So you can't go Rocky 1, 2, 3. There you go. There's my picks. Okay, everybody knows this by now because obviously you've all watched every episode. So away we go. Which one of you fellas would like to go first?
Larry. Well, let me go first as alphabetically the first of Larry and Paul.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with one of the greatest films of all time, but that moved me so much, but it does every single time I watch it without fail. Very and that is that is Into the Wild.
If you want something in life, reach out and grab it.
Oh, wow. Good pick, yeah.
Is that a film?
That's my film.
Interesting.
It's my first film. Emil Hirsch plays Christopher McCandless. It was based on a book by a journalist whose name I've forgotten for the moment. And it's about a young lad who ditches the riches, which is, I could be a rapper, who decides he doesn't want, like, sort of the Harvard life and the very sort of staid, wealthy, upper middle class American life, and goes off traveling, takes himself off to Alaska by himself. And, well, you probably know it, but it's the most stunning piece of work. Just the visually, it's incredible. The performances are amazing. It's directed by Sean Penn. The soundtrack was almost up there for my soundtrack to take as well, because
I thought you were going to go for that as a soundtrack.
I'll explain why later.
You're throwing a curveball in.
But Sean Penn went to Eddie Vedder of Pearl Jam and said, "I fancy you for this soundtrack." Eddie Vedder had been working on his ukulele.
First of all, he said, "I fancy you," didn't he?
Yes, he said,
"I fancy you." Then he said, "I fancy you for the soundtrack."
Yes, yeah. Mm. So the soundtrack's incredible as well, and it all just comes to. I think I always describe it as the perfect pairing of music and film that I've seen. I know there's tons of things that other people will say, but it's just a beautiful film, and I cry every single time I watch it.
So when was the first time you saw it?
Much later than it came out, I think, because I don't think I saw it for the first time until
last week.
Until it must have been something like 2012, something like that. And then I've seen it every time it comes on the TV. If I see if it's coming on the TV on linear, I'll watch it at the same time as some other people and try and tweet about it to get people into watching it. I've probably seen it maybe 6 or 7 times. It's I sort of toyed briefly with The Matrix. Whoa. Because that's the film I've watched most in my life, probably about, I watched that 50 or 60 times, you know, when it first came out on VHS. Look it up, kids. And
The Matrix used to be the reason you bought a DVD player.
That's it. It was one of the first ones on DVD, and everybody bought it.
So. And everyone bought it. So I used to work in Currys, or if you're not allowed to say that, not high street retailer. They were retail parks. And I remember I used to love it because, and also the only reason you would buy a surround sound set was for The Matrix, because loads of these 5.1 sets came out. And I remember that we had like a demonstration room in which was like a Sony, you know, probably got quite a hand. And we used to love to be the salesperson who got to demonstrate the quality of, because it wasn't LED then. It wasn't even LCD. I think it was plasma, you know, Sony Trinitron plasma. No, it wouldn't even been plasma. It would have been CRT. And this, the Matrix, the DVD player and the surround sound, it was incredible.
Yeah, well, I wasn't rich enough for the DVD initially, although we did get it later.
You got the VHS.
Yeah, we had the VHS, certainly, originally.
I was so geeky. I got the import Region 1 DVD of Matrix. Because it had extra bits of people getting headbutted and punched.
Yeah.
All about 3 seconds or something. Yeah.
It's amazing what the BBFC cut, wasn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, I feel like we could have talked more about The Matrix, but my point was, that's a film I can watch over and over again and just really enjoy over and over again. But Into the Wild is a film I can watch over, I can watch it every now and again and not fail to be moved by it. And it's so life-affirming. And so rich. So I absolutely love it. Have you seen
that's kind of a that's a bit of a Boris nod, that one, actually.
He's seen it, but he wasn't aware it was a film.
I wasn't told
it was a film. Even though I made it.
What's the N stand for?
North.
Your great Alaskan adventure.
So, shall we go straight onto your film then?
Absolutely, yeah. Now, I was of two minds on how to approach this session, if you will. I was either going to try and wow the people who watch slash listen to it, like Scroobius Pip, and try and choose the most obscure films I enjoy, but I've decided...
Like Messiah.
Yeah, exactly. Or Ghostbusters 2. But what I've decided to do is I've really thought about it, being on a desert island, and what would I genuinely like to watch over and over and over and over and over and over again. And I've gone for films that I probably have watched over and over and over and over and over and over again.
You can't go risky. You couldn't go like something, because
I've seen twice, because who knows, in 10 years I'll be like, I'm absolutely sick of that.
I've been rattling on about Tick, Tick, Boom, and I was like, should I choose Tick, Tick, Boom? And then I thought, I don't know how I'll feel about Tick,
Tick, Boom. It's not bedded
in 10 years' time.
It's not bedded in.
Andrew Garfield might fall from grace. Now
it's off our chest. What do you think?
He won't. He's a lovely man.
All right. I thought, what, do you know something?
It's a great film, though, Tick, Tick, Boom. Yeah. Absolutely. Boom, that was really good.
Yeah, it's sensational. Anyway, you carry on.
Right, sorry. I've gone for films that I know I watch over and over again, and I would like to take to Desert Island. Now, I am an incredible Bond geek. And it did irk me that I wasn't allowed to choose the whole of the Eon Bond canon, the official series. So I've had to. You've made me choose one, which I hate you for. But I'll do it. And I've gone for Casino Royale, a 2006 film, obviously.
Oh.
Not the 1967 unofficial one. I've gone for Casino Royale because it's the I was going to say the best, but it depends on what mood I'm in. Where, sometimes if I go and watch a Bond, and I've seen them many times, I'll be like, what mood am I in? Do I want Sean Connery in Japan? Do I want to be moved a bit by George Lazenby at Christmas time? Do I want Roger Moore going into space? But I think Casino Royale is probably the film that ticks the most boxes for me. I've seen it a lot. I even went to go, there still is a phase of live orchestras playing the soundtrack while the film shows. And I think I would gain the most out of it if I was stuck on the desert island.
Mm. I think it's also the quintessential Daniel Craig Bond as well.
They fell off a cliff after Quantum of Solace. Well, maybe after Skyfall. The last two.
The Quantum of Solace. It's a bit like the Back to the Futures. So Quantum of Solace works as the middle film. When you go, yes. When you've seen them all, the three sort of together, and well, actually now it's five, isn't it? Five. When you work in the story arc, it works better. But at the time, as an individual movie, I struggled with Quantum of Solace because it was like, not really a lot happens. It's a set for the next one, and it kind of drifts.
It works for me. It works well as Casino Royale Part 2. If you watch them as one, that makes sense. I think that the frustrating thing about Quantum of Solace was that there was a writer's strike that happened that completely scuppered it. There was threats of an actor strike happening, about to happen as well. So they had to film it then and write it. And as a result, it's a bit, I really like it. Like, it's really stylishly made, but it's kind of quite boring in parts. And then when he finally finds Vesper's boyfriend, you're like, ah, here we go. And then the film ends.
Yeah. The thing I love about Casino Royale and always remember is the opening, because you've come off Pierce Brosnan being Bond.
Bromsman.
Pierce Brosnan being Bond, haven't you?
And,
you know, crashing a tank through that building.
That was GoldenEye.
I know, but I'm talking about the style.
You can't knock GoldenEye.
I love Brosnan.
The game that it spun off, which was created. Yeah,
of course.
But it's set to be, might be being re-released this year.
It's not going to be the same. Let's be honest. They're going to make it really good. And the whole thing about it was that it was all... Anyway, so we're digressing.
I'll still lose at the dam every time on the N64.
First level.
Yeah. The point about that was that I really liked Pierce Brosnan, and Bond to me was that sort of Roger Moore, Pierce Brosnan, a bit raised eyebrow. I thought Christmas only came once a year, you know, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
So when Daniel Craig came, I mean, the opening of Casino Royale, the black and white, the smashing the face into the sink, the parkour sort of chase.
That wasn't in black and white.
It wasn't in black and white. No, but it moved on by then.
And you're ruining it. Come on, you're setting it up.
the tension in that crowd scene at the beginning, and you were like, oh, I mean, that was mind-blowing and still is when you watch it, when you think about what came before. And Casino Royale wasn't too long.
No, it was long, but not too long.
No, it was,
It was the longest Bond to that point.
But it never felt long.
No.
Quantum of Solace felt long to me.
Really? Because that's the shortest Bond.
Yeah, but Skyfall felt longish to me.
And that.
But it felt more sort of Lord of the Rings, what's the word I'm looking for?
Extended edition?
Big adventure style film.
Lots of walking,
I do love Skyfall, but God, Casino Royale was definitely, for me, it's my favourite.
Yeah.
Bond, I think also the other thing with Casino Royale is Chris Cornell's tune.
Oh, yeah.
The
Bond theme is absolutely bang on. And I think also the thing with Casino Royale was, because after Pierce Brosnan, the Bourne films came out. Well, not the name dropping on me, but you know, the Bourne films came out, and so there was a different style of spy thriller. So, you know, they had to sort of modernise. I suppose. And and Daniel Craig was the right guy at the right time.
Definitely. The Bond series is always adapted. Like, it's always something's come out and they've gone, okay, let's do this now. Like, for example, Moonraker was a reaction to Star Wars, Man with the Golden Gun is a reaction to Bruce Lee films, Live and Let Die is a reaction to Blaxploitation. You know, the only time they've really set a trend was in the 60s when they were making, you know, when they launched Spy Mania.
Yeah. But
Casino Royale got the best of the Bourne films. And restarted Bond in a really exciting way. And
do you think it'll change dramatically again? Like, get Anthony Hopkins in as Bond, or
an elderly Bond.
Who do you think is going to be the next Bond then? Come on, we might as well discuss this. Who are we looking at?
There's no one really hugely on my radar. I remember, so I used to, this is how geeky I was. I used to host a James Bond fan podcast for CommanderBond.net. And I remember, I was so into it. I remember watching Layer Cake, and I was interviewed on an Irish radio station because I was a big Bond geek, and they said, who do you think will be the next Bond? And it was around the time that they were auditioning Henry Cavill, who was unknown, a guy called Goran Vishnich, who was in ER. There was Sam Worthington, who was the main Australian guy who was in Avatar, And no one was talking about this outlier. And I was like, I watched this film called Layer Cake the other day, and I really think Daniel Craig would make an excellent Bond. And that was like in 2004.
Well done.
Who knew how prescient I was?
Yeah.
But there's no one like that now. I haven't watched anything and went, he'd make a good Bond. There's no one that I see. There's lots of people who come close.
Yeah.
But there's no one who I watch and go, that would be interesting.
Trouble is, Cavill is just, his face is too known as Superman and as The Witcher, isn't he? I just think
he's too... Man from Uncle as well, so he's kind of done the spy thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
And also he's not an exciting, dynamic actor, is he?
No.
He does what he does, and that's great, but what about Tom Hardy? Because
no, he's too old.
Tom Hardy, for me, is, no, not the same with Idris Elba. I think they're on the wrong age scale, because one of the reasons Daniel Craig has said is he's too old, and Idris Elba's the same age as Daniel Craig, so I can't see that. It's going to be one of these young actors like that guy who's in Poldark or someone like that. It'll be someone entirely left field you won't see coming.
And I wouldn't be surprised if they go for someone young, maybe someone we haven't even heard of at the moment, and they go back to when Bond was in the Navy, or was in the S, where they rebooted his story, but he's an SBS soldier, Daniel Craig.
Yeah.
Because before that, he was meant to be Royal Navy Reserve. But I reckon they'll probably reboot it, and they'll make it even younger, and they'll have him before he's even been recruited to MI6.
You know what my theory is?
Go on.
Bond Cinematic Universe.
Because of Amazon.
The multiverse.
The multiverse is the true. I mean, the multiverse is true because obviously, in No Time to Die, spoiler alert, Bond dies.
Well,
so the multiverse is true. So that's a fact now.
But I think that you look at Ana de Armas's character, for example, in No Time to Die, they've got a ready-made spin-off with her.
They had a ready-made spin-off with Jinx from Dying of the Day with Wayne.
Yeah, they talked about this every film. We're going to have spin-offs, and they never
manage it. But I mean, the interesting thing now, Amazon has bought MGM, and obviously Amazon is huge multimedia studio. But the Broccoli family are insisting that it's going to just be the Bond series. But it would be surprising if they didn't try to mine that for some kind of...
Yeah.
Maybe Jeff Bezos would be the next Bond.
Oh, God. Blofeld. He'd make a good Blofeld, wouldn't he? We're going up in space with this cock-shaped rocket. But what would be interesting...
That's real life.
But what would be really interesting that will never happen, unfortunately, because of product placement, is taking Bond back to the 50s, back to a Cold War spy. But that can never happen because, Nokia can't sell the latest phones.
And he can't drink Heineken, can he?
He can drink Heineken in the 50s.
Can he?
He can, absolutely.
Oh, excellent. Well, there you go. It's back
but
on.
The product placement wouldn't work. But what would work is if they did a Bond TV series set in the 50s, where the product placement wasn't that necessary.
Well, James Bond Jr. or something.
Charlie Hickson ever been mined for film, have they?
No, and I'm not sure whether the literary Bond can be.
Right.
No. Yeah.
There we are.
Yeah. Literary Bond is probably going to struggle in today's woke society. There I use that.
Oh yeah, well, they're still making the books, but I'm not sure whether the films can borrow from the new books or not.
Because of rules
and that.
Right, okay. Yeah.
I was quite partial to the John Gardner books when he took over, and they were all pretty good.
Yeah, so, they were pretty violent, I remember those books.
Yeah.
That's how I kind of got into, I got into Bond through GoldenEye, a computer game, and then I read the books, and then I watched the films. I remember that sort of quite a thrill. The John Gardner ones were pretty
great. They were good.
He drove a Saab.
Once you go Saab, you never go back.
Exactly.
I don't know about that. Anyway, so tell us, how did you come up with the concept? I mean, there's the obvious where the real Downing Street briefings came from, obviously from our dear government at the moment. Yeah. But which one of you came up with the concept and how did it all occur? And because it suddenly took off, didn't it?
It was quite a thrill. It was quite a roller coaster ride, wasn't it? We were in the first lockdown. We'd been working at the BBC doing a radio show, and then it didn't. And then we were put on pause.
Weren't sacked.
We weren't sacked for 20 months, and then we were sacked at the end of that.
We are now sacked.
But we were both at home, obviously locked down, and then we were talking about sketches that we could do.
We still try to do sketches every week and try to do live show.
And I noticed that there was a Downing Street briefing. They used to, in the early days, they used to go live on the news channels to the briefing room before anybody would turn up because it was new. And, as far as people was concerned, it was sort of exciting, that we're waiting here for the Prime Minister to come out. It was sort of like Oval Office stuff. And so I realised, oh, there's a bunch of footage there of this empty room and do some trickery. And that was it. Then we were sort of getting excited about scripting it and got some other people involved.
To go a bit further back, we did a little sketch maybe a few months before called Every Political Interview Ever, Every Political Debate Ever. It was a piss take of Radio 4 and how they handled political debates. And that got a little bit of traction with, I think Neil Howell played it on his show on Five Live. And it was about everyone was talking in the abstract. They were saying things like, I'm agreeing with that by nodding, or ramping up the tone, pointing to you and saying, that's not fair, or that sort of thing. So we thought, how's about we do something like that, but with these bullshit COVID briefings that they're doing, you know, sort of awkward eyes, looking forward, insincere tone, using very clear, far too much. And then that's how it started. And we did that, and that took off. It went crazy.
Yeah, it had more views than anything we'd ever done,
probably all put together. Yeah. And then we sort of forgot about it and moved on with our lives and carried on. And then our friend, the excellent radio broadcaster and journalist, Martin Kellner, came and visited us in our offices. And he said to us, you need to be doing more, putting out more stuff. I'm like, oh, Martin, we're doing sketches and we're doing a live show and we're trying to pay the rent. There's nothing else we can do. And he was like, well, I think you should be putting out more stuff. So then we bashed our heads together and thought, what can we quite easily replicate? You know, because it takes ages once you write something to film it and then to sort of edit it and then to put it out. But all of that's a big job. So I'd already made these Photoshop assets of the lectern and the background and all this stuff. So I thought, well, why don't we just do a real daily briefing? We call it hashtag real daily briefing. And we put them out like once a week. So that's how it started. And we started doing them every week, to varying degrees of success. Like some weeks we'll get, you know, hundreds of thousands of views. Some weeks we'll get tens.
And now 10. Gary Lineker follows us.
And so now Gary Lineker, as of yesterday, followed us.
A new friend, Gary Lineker,
dear friend, Gaz, as we call him, Gaz.
Yeah, yeah. Even though he did badger him into following you, but we won't.
Whoa!
What?
One tweet. We did know, fair enough. We bullied him into,
That's bullying. Yeah, I mean, well, it's not actually, because, you know, that would have to go to a committee to review it to make sure that it was, and then it would be decided that actually, no.
Yeah, it's alleged bullying.
Alleged, and it probably didn't even happen in the first place because it happened 3 weeks ago, so that's historical. Exactly.
No one told us it was bullying.
No.
Yeah. So we weren't sure that it was bullying, yeah.
So we sort of finished we carry on doing those briefings, and every time we think, oh, we're fed up with these now, there's nothing more to do, something happens, we get off the... let's do another one, but we're desperately trying to do other stuff while we do the real daily briefings. So
for the inevitable fall from grace from Mr. Johnson, which it seems is picking up steam again, because the latest thing I've seen in the news is that the 2019ers, as they're calling them, i.e. the ones who got the red wall breakers, I don't know what you call them, they're all now submitting these letters. So if you've got something in mind for when he does go, or are you just going to wait and see what he does and then...
We're always... I mean, I've been talking far too much and I apologise.
That's okay.
We're always really conscious of something happening. Like, you know, one week it can be, you know, him leaving. The other week, we always sort of wait till the Prime Minister's questions. Then invariably, if you're always waiting for something, you never end up putting anything out. So... I think we'll have a cutoff, won't we, tomorrow?
Yeah, yeah.
And then if he hasn't gone by tomorrow...
And the interesting thing, though, about anyone who makes online comedy, and they'll all say the same, particularly in satire, is that how are you going to do it differently? If you're going to film something, so even if something happened, we wrote it, we filmed it, we put it out, even if you were rapid with that, you're looking at 3 hours, probably. Well, in 3 hours, every single joke has been made on Twitter.
Yeah.
Every single joke. So how are you coming at it? How are we going to come at it differently? And that's, so we do need to think about what happens when Boris goes, but sometimes it's almost better to let it happen, let it come out in the wash a little bit. What are the details? You know, I mean, obviously it'll be hilarious if he is the shortest serving prime minister of the 21st century.
He wouldn't be of all time, would he?
No, he's going back quite a long time though, I think.
I'll take that.
And he wants to be regarded as the best prime minister ever, and he's going to be regarded as the world-beatingly worst.
That's prime possible.
Minister. I think so, yeah.
Who knew?
Yeah, I know. And he had some serious competition for that. So, Yeah, he's done, right? I've got to say, for one thing in his life,
Some people think we're Tory bashers, and we're not really. We'd like to think that we're satirists, so we're or holding
political comedians.
Yeah, we're holding the government to account, and they happen to be Tories,
and they have been for the past
forever,
13 years.
Yeah,
it's 12 years.
12 years.
Since,
sorry,
since the start of the coalition. Yeah. You know, and for a, you know, you hark back now to the days of David Cameron, and even though he's regarded by many as the worst prime minister ever because
and a ham-faced prick
because of the referendum which tore the country apart, which you have to say is a massive, massive deal.
Yeah.
You look back at David Cameron now and you go, I sort of wish we had him instead of these guys.
Yeah.
Because him and George Osborne, whatever you thought about them and their policies, and you could debate those politically, they were at least serious people.
At least they stood for something as opposed to standing for themselves. Yeah.
Gordon Brown, I think Gordon Brown was one of the biggest missed opportunities this country ever had. He was just a serious person, but he wasn't, you know, a personality leader.
Yeah.
So, you know, the media.
Well, I think actually the biggest miss this country ever had was John Smith, who unfortunately died before his time.
And we'll never know, do we? It's hard to think.
He was well liked, wasn't he?
Yeah. But then, you know, Tony Blair was, and you have to be careful with this because Iraq, but it doesn't, you know, it doesn't discount everything good that happened. And Tony Blair wasn't the government. He had a whole Labour government underneath him, and lots of great things happened at the time. So, you know, the children's centres being, you know, one of them. And I don't know what I'm saying anymore, but I just think.
So basically,
I wish we didn't have this shower.
So with these briefings, it wouldn't matter who was in power; you would still approach it the same way. So, say for whatever reason.
Yeah, we'd like to think that whoever was in power, we'd find something to take the piss out of, and we would take the piss out of it.
Yeah, it's just this particular group
are constantly
doing terrible things. It would seem, and it's not. That's not even the big thing. The big thing is the constant deceit.
Yeah,
and they know that. Really, they can still talk to their base and take everybody else for fools. They know that all of them are going on TV at the moment being deceitful.
Yeah.
It's just the standard play. So therefore, there's a lot to take the piss out of.
Mm. So, get back onto more entertaining things.
Yeah.
So, come on then, Aaron, let's have your second movie.
My second movie, after all that politics talk, my second movie is Bruce Almighty.
Bruce Almighty.
Oh, wow. Excellent.
Because I thought if I'm going to be stuck on this desert island watching Into the Wild, crying every week, I need something that's going to cheer me up. And I think Bruce Almighty is almost the perfect comedy film with someone at the absolute top of their game. Two people, when you think about Jim Carrey and Steve Carell, you know, Jennifer Aniston's brilliant in it. It's got so much heart. Morgan Freeman is actually playing God.
As well as being him in real life.
Which is the role he was born to play.
Mm. Mm.
It's just, to me, it's just absolutely perfect. Any time it's on, I can watch it at any moment. It will make me laugh. Jim Carrey, whose birthday was yesterday as we recorded.
Yeah, it was.
60th birthday.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, what a hero, you know. And I just think it's got so many gags in it, but it's got so much heart at the same time. And it's sort of a silly concept, but it's so good that you can go along with it. You know, it doesn't take you out of the film. Totally.
Brilliant moments in that film, like when he just starts saying yes to all the prayers and everything goes absolutely chaotic and falling apart. And I just think that's so well positioned in the film that it's, you know, not that straightforward. Yeah,
I mean, it's deep philosophy, really, isn't it? It's like, what would happen if everybody got what they wanted? It would be a terrible disaster. So, what does that tell you about life? You know, it's Buddhist. It's all life is suffering, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's the moment where he pulls the moon a bit closer. Yeah. For Jennifer's purposes and causes a tsunami, which is
actually do.
Yeah, yeah. And the dog going to the toilet and flushing the loo, reading the paper on the toilet. I think yeah. I can always watch it. My wife and I will always sit and watch it if it's on, because it's just consistently funny. And that's it hasn't got old.
No. And I like you saying about Steve Carell as well, because he had the Anchorman thing going on. But that bit where he... Did you think much of the sequel with Steve Carell?
I quite liked Evan Almighty, but it didn't have the same thing as Bruce Almighty had. I mean,
he was Noah in that, wasn't he? Is that right?
Yeah.
I
did like it. I enjoyed it, but nothing like the first one.
Well, there's nothing like Jim Carrey, really, is there? I mean, that man is just a force of nature.
Yeah. Well, if you try to get that cast together today, what's that going to cost? It was sort of before Carell was huge.
Yeah.
But he was so good in it, and it was obviously a vehicle for Jim Carrey. But it's a synergy, isn't it? It's a coming together that happens sometimes.
It's the alignment of the planets,
yeah,
the cinematic planets,
quite literally, yeah.
A bit like you two, really, the coming together of two forces of nature and end up creating.
Yeah,
but like that, but like we're a lot more budget. We're a lot cheaper. Yeah.
And which one of us is Jennifer Aniston?
Jim Carrey, though.
Me.
Yeah, I think it might be a little bit cheaper than Jim Carrey.
Possibly.
Only just.
Yeah, one trailer.
Or the human that is called Jim Carrey.
Yeah.
Because there is no self.
Yeah, he's a alternate universe being or something, isn't he?
I would just love to sit down.
Around.
Yeah. His paintings are great as well.
What a guy. What an interesting guy.
Yeah.
Brilliant. So then, Paul, we'll move on to your second choice now.
I found this incredibly hard, I want you to know. Right up until the last minute. And again, I went for the same philosophy. I could try and be, cinematic, not snob, but, think of really highfalutin things. I went for quite simply one of the films that affected me the most when I watched it and had the biggest impact on me when I was little. And that has got to be Batman, 1989, Michael Keaton, Jack Nicholson, Kim Basinger. What a film.
What are you? I'm Batman.
What a great film.
What Sam a film.
Prince, directed by Tim Burton, everything.
Yeah. I mean, it was the, the template to you should say Superman probably was, but I mean, Batman started the modern superhero film template, blockbuster. It was crazy. I remember being just young enough to remember that symbol that was ubiquitous. It was everywhere. It was on everything from thermos flasks, baseball caps, boxer shorts.
Bus stops. They used to nick the poster, didn't they, at bus stops?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, it was that or Batman Returns, because those two films are incredible.
Yeah.
Batman Returns, the best Christmas film. I won't have anyone.
That's Die Hard. That's Die Hard.
Absolutely wrong.
Didn't Jonathan Ross call Batman Returns the best film ever made?
No, that was on the VHS of Batman Forever.
Right,
possibly the greatest movie ever made.
Brilliant.
In fact, there's a story behind that where he was, I think, apparently he said he was being ironic. And apparently when he went to the premiere, it was there above the, Odeon Leicester Square, and he was mortified.
I'm sure he just wasn't drunk.
Or quite possibly pissed, yeah. But, I mean, it's either that or Batman Returns. Batman Returns I really, really, really love. But for me, Batman was the one that I watched it, and it sparked an absolute obsession with Batman. And that was the obsession that happened before the James Bond obsession. But, Danny Elfman, what a theme song.
Yeah.
What a soundtrack. The Prince one, not so much. I remember I loved the Prince soundtrack, and I got it. I think I rented it, the CD from the library, back in Peterborough. And I remember thought, the songs are really good. And it has a lot special place in my heart. But Danny Elfman's soundtrack is incredible. And of course, Michael Keaton this year, if you're watching this in the present, is coming back in The Flash and coming back in Batwoman. He's playing Batman again. He's playing Bruce Wayne again. And Michael Keaton is definitively... objectively and definitively the best Batman.
Factually.
That's correct. That is correct.
Say that again, sorry.
That is absolutely correct, 100%. Michael Keaton is the best cinema Batman, for sure.
Yeah, And a bit like I chose, obviously, Daniel Craig's Casino Royale has been, I mean, they both got similarly lambasted by fans. You know, I remember there was a mad letter writing campaign when Michael Keaton was announced. People writing to Warner Brothers saying, oh, you've killed Batman, you're going to make it camp, it's going to be awful. Michael Keaton's terrible. They did the same with Daniel Craig, and they both absolutely smashed it out of the park.
I prefer Ben Affleck.
Do you?
Really?
Do you know what? When we're talking about
it, I don't think I've seen it.
Really? Well, you're not missing out much. The Black and White Justice League was really good, but Batman versus Superman was pants. But I thought he was the best thing in it, and it's a shame that we weren't given a more of him and Jeremy Irons as Alfred.
Can I ask two musical Batman questions? Yeah. Which one was "Hold Me, Thrill Me, Kiss Me, Kill Me" in the U2 song?
Batman Forever.
And which was "Kiss from a Rose" from?
Batman Forever.
Oh, right, both from Batman. Oh, that's a good soundtrack, isn't it?
Yeah.
Really good. Interestingly, Batman Forever, this is going to be a bit boring for everybody watching, but tough luck, it's my show. I used to work at a cinema in Maidstone, down in Kent, you know, sunny, up, all that jazz, true blue Tory state. Try not to get political. They did a carnival every year, and working at the cinema, Batman Forever was coming out that summer, so I had to dress up as Batman. And my colleague was the Riddler, and he had because I didn't fancy the tight green spandex. I went with the motorcycle boots that were too big for me, and you know, the cowl and everything. It was great. And I, you know, kids running up to me in the middle, I love you, Batman. And I'm like, I'm not really a Batman kid, but hey, I'll take it. But yeah, that was brilliant. Yeah, walking along. Yeah, so that's kind of my moment as Batman. Yeah.
Oh, I even now as a grown adult, something that my partner absolutely will not allow, but one day will happen. I want a proper Batman suit.
Before you carry on, just want to say, it's family show, careful what you say.
I want a full Batman suit. I'm talking about the urethane, like, you know, I think it'd be the Batman Returns one, which to me is the pinnacle of Batman's costumery. But I will have one day that costume will be mine, and I won't look sad and pathetic in it.
Not the Batmobile, then.
Oh my God. Yes, right? That is... I'm sorry, hands down, a work of automotive art, and it has yet to be bettered. That Batmobile is just, it's insane. Even now, you look at it now, imagine, I mean, apparently it's impossible to drive because of the length of the front.
Yeah.
But what a car.
Yeah.
And the reveal, oh, I forgot about the Batmobile. Oh, stop it.
Well, again, that Batman was brilliant because, like you said, that before it had been the Christopher Reeve Supermans, which had kind of been murdered by canon when they did Quest of Peace, which I know people love, and it is quite kitsch, but it was effectively killed superhero movies. And then they came back, as we were saying earlier, the marketing campaign was just there for about a year, just pushing out the logo, and everybody was sucking into it. And I just remember seeing that, the first bit when Nicholson turns around and goes, "The Joker," like that. It is just, these are just cinematic moments, and it's a brilliant, brilliant film. Brilliant. Yeah. The film I got on DVD from the States because it was unedited.
Yes, well, they released, I remember 2005, they released the four film collection on DVD with the documentaries. What was really interesting is Joel Schumacher, of course, who went on to direct Batman Forever and Batman and Robin, actually apologised for Batman and Robin, which was lovely.
As well he should, as has George Clooney apologised for it as well.
Yeah,
as
but
well.
It launched his career, didn't it, ironically?
Yeah. Yeah,
awesome. And then Batman was obviously rebooted. I mean, yeah. I'm not sure how much into Batman I was as a kid, but In the same way Casino Royale blew me away, Batman Begins, I loved.
Yeah.
And then The Dark Knight, obviously, is unquestionably one of the best films of all time, never mind superheroes.
But yeah, it was all about the reboots in 2005, 2006, wasn't it? With Batman Begins doing it first and then Casino Royale doing it with Bond. But yeah, I mean, Batman, Jack Nicholson, what a winner. What a Joker. Again, final Joker. Sorry.
What a Joker.
What a Joker.
So yeah, because again, you're talking about Batman Begins. Batman Begins is like Quantum of Solace. Once again, it works better when the other two films are with it. It's a good film, but it works better as part of that trilogy because you go back to it and go, Ra's al Ghul makes sense now.
Yeah,
because Liam Neeson kind of wandered around in that film. And you're like, and then once you've seen the other two, then it all falls into place. And I think it's but no, absolutely, Michael Keaton, best Batman for me, absolutely, 100%. I am quite partial to the 60s Adam West Batman, but that's because I used to come home from school and Batman would be on after school. And I'm not a 60s child, but beyond in the 70s as well. Just
absolutely.
Adam West.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, and also, have you watched Batman the movie of late? It's filth. Absolute, unbridled filth.
Sexy.
It is. Yeah. It's quite racy, yeah.
You can't get rid of a bomb as a kid. Yeah. Or when Catwoman messages the underworld. Yeah. There's a scene where she messages the underworld. She gets out like a powder compact or something.
Yeah.
And she very suggestive finger movements in a very suggestive place. Face value when you're a kid. And you watch it as an adult. Like when he's rolling around going.
Some days you just can't get rid of a bomb.
You don't appreciate just how funny that is when you're a kid. Yeah. You appreciate how, you know, on the baseline, but as an adult, you're watching it and you're unironically laughing. It's great.
Yeah, like he runs around the corner and there's the nuns, and then he turns and there's like ducklings in the water. It's brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. So getting back to your, obviously, we talked about the briefing. So, and you've just recently done a live on YouTube event. You were in a venue, were you? Or was it? It was just on YouTube.
We're here in our live penthouse overlooking Leeds.
Apocalypse.
Yeah, post-apocalypse. We do a live show every Thursday on YouTube, youtube.com/Larry and Paul.
It's small but perfectly formed.
We have a
below here so everybody can follow and join along.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah, lovely. And we have a loyal band of flaps, as we call them.
Yeah, fans of Larry and Paul.
Yeah, flaps.
Flaps.
Who join in? It's lots of fun. So we weren't sacked. Oh, we are now by the BBC. We wanted to carry on doing live broadcasting, so we decided to take our radio show and just do it with a camera in our studio and do it live, which is lots of fun.
Yeah, we enjoy it.
Yeah.
So obviously you've come to prominence in kind of COVID times. So whatever we call it, I don't know what we're going to call it when we look back at it. We're probably COVID times. Yeah. Moving forward, have you guys got any plans for what you're going to do once we finally get out of all these restrictions? And are you going to tour? Are you going to, what are we looking at here? Are we just going to
do less political comedy?
Yeah, we've got a lot of plans. One of the big problems we face at the moment is deciding what we want to do next, because there's loads of stuff that we like doing. So we love live broadcasting. You know, we still do love radio to some extent, but we love doing sketches. We like doing political comedy. We want to move away from that. We want to do some longer form stuff. We want to work on some audio comedy and develop some stuff. And we want to work with other Northern comedians. We've got a production company in Leeds to try and sort of wheel out some of those Northern comedians that can't really get a career in comedy or anything because they have to go down to London in order to do it.
Yeah,
so we've got our
champion Northern voices.
We've got lots of irons in lots of fires.
But you know, like the influencer Molly May said, you know, she has the same 24 hours as the rest of us, and you know, there's only 24 hours in a day, aren't there? It's just tough to decide what to do.
Yeah, and we've got to sleep for 12 of those.
Apparently.
So, what is next? What is upcoming for you next, apart from Boris's farewell tour? What else you got coming this way soon?
Well, there's talk of us maybe moving into doing some actual live events at some point soon. We're talking about doing that. Plodding away, I think, mainly just sort of chipping away and seeing what happens. There's a chance I might be going up to Edinburgh this year in August, which if that happens, then you're going to come up as well. We're going to try and do something up there.
Yeah. So yeah, that's a really non-committal answer, isn't it? Because we don't sort of really know.
We should be planning more.
But like you say, you're busy. So we're good, you know. It's not like you're going, well, this is actually all we're doing.
If it was just a daily briefing, we would be bored and broke.
Yeah. All the bees.
So would you hope to be unsacked by the BBC at some point? Or is it something you would go back to? Or
I don't think we'd go back to what we were doing before.
No.
Yeah.
I think down the line, you know, we're big defenders of the BBC and have been in recent days because of Nadine Dorries's just sort of unilateral decision.
Who's since backtracked on that, I might add.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she backtracked on it earlier today.
Oh, wonderful.
Right. Well, yeah, who knows? But we love, you know, the BBC, certain parts of it, and I think we'd quite happily have a relationship again with them in the future, but I think it's got to be right, hasn't it?
That sentence sounded, imagine if you were describing an ex-partner.
Yeah.
We said we love certain parts of that, our ex-partner. Yeah. Well, we certainly like a relationship with the future.
Yeah, I like forearms and shoulders. And,
lovely thighs. Certain parts.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it would be nice if we go back to radio, I think. That would be nice. At some point, under the right circumstances. But at the moment, we're enjoying ploughing our own furrow.
You're talking about your ex again?
Yeah.
So do you find having this creative medium online easier than, say, a more structured approach of a organisation?
Not necessarily. I mean, the radio show was very different. I mean, I was, because we worked at the BBC, we were sort of limited in some ways as to what we could say. We certainly couldn't have done all this political comedy.
I could have.
While we were still there.
I could have.
You could have, but they probably would have taken you, because you were a freelancer, but they probably would have taken you off air sooner rather than later. So
cowards.
I don't know what I was saying there. What was I saying there?
Well, we enjoy working for ourselves. That's what's nice. That's what's nice.
Yeah.
Coming into this office that we rent, having a space that we sit down in and go, right, what are we going to do today?
We're going to muck around and not achieve anything.
Look at cat videos on YouTube and then go home. No, it's lovely to work for ourselves. It's really good.
It does bring its own pressures, doesn't it? And
paying the rent is one.
Yes, that's one big one. I think it's good. I think it does. It has driven us forward. We took an office in the September of the first pandemic year, so September 2020,
when everyone else was working from home.
Yeah,
and it was the best thing we ever did.
It was, yeah.
Did you get it quite cheap?
Not bad.
Yeah, it's all right. I mean, it doesn't have any windows.
The windowless void. Yeah,
exactly. Well, daylight, I find, is overrated anyway. Who needs that? I'm Irish, so daylight only burns me.
It's nice because our office is in a place called Prime Studios, which is in the media corridor of Leeds. So it's next door to where Emmerdale is filmed. It's next door to ITV.
Kay Mellor works downstairs, the writer and director.
Yeah. So there's lots going on, and lots of TV production companies are actually in this building, which is fantastic for us because we've got a lot to learn, obviously, in that field. And there are loads of really nice people, particularly in Yorkshire, who are happy to spend time with you and teach you stuff that you just have no clue about.
Yeah, it's all quite exciting.
So, which draws us now on to your joint choice, which I'm quite excited about here. This is we've had some great choices so far.
Thank you.
So the joint choice is going to be interesting. I'm kind of expecting All the President's Men, but you know.
You're thinking something political.
Sorry?
You're thinking something political.
Yeah, I was thinking about it. It's possibly too obvious. I don't know.
Well, so we talked about this off air with you. We used to host a film podcast back in 2008, 2009, 2010, and where we reviewed films that came out. So as a consequence, we got to watch a load of films together.
Yeah.
As we were becoming really good friends, I guess, we sort of getting to know each other and seeing films together and got to review them. And so there was lots of shared experiences of excellent films we watched. And when we were thinking about what would be our joint film, we immediately went to some of those, some of the best ones we saw.
Some of the ones we gave 5 stars, for example.
Oh, yeah. For example, we watched Marley and Me. And I've never had, you know, that bit when you're, that feeling when you're trying not to cry so hard that there's just pain. I remember just that film finishing and just being like,
it was just us in the cinema at 9:30 in the morning at a press viewing.
In Leeds.
And we came out at 11:30.
We couldn't talk for about 45 minutes. Yeah. Because if we did, we would have...
but also, we saw like...
The island, though. I think you'd probably hang yourself from that tree behind me.
Yeah.
Which would probably bend down and your feet would touch the ground.
Yeah, I'm quite tall, so that
it would be effective. But Let the Right One In was another one we considered.
That was right up there.
Like that.
Watching that, you know, and I hate the fact that Hollywood believes it needs to remake these things. Let the Right One In was just had such an atmosphere and such
it
a
was
mood.
So beautiful.
Down to the sound design. I remember the sound of the snow falling on the ground.
Yeah.
Incredible. And then we thought...
But I thought the Hollywood version, Let Me In, was good because they did it shot for shot and word for word pretty much. Unlike the Dragon Tattoo remakes with Daniel Craig, which I think weren't quite as good as the original.
The first one was all right, but then they kind of they kind of lost it a bit. But yeah, I mean, see, again, Dragon Tattoo, you can't mess with the originals because...
No. So, but then we thought horror, we're going to go on a desert island together and watch a fairly scary horror film again and again. So we didn't go for that. We went for, guess what?
Yeah.
Something that's political.
And something that one of our, when we were first becoming friends, we were like, what do you like? We like this. We shared our comedy love. And one of our main comedy influences was Armando Iannucci, the creator of like Veep, David Copperfield, and he... Death of Stalin, co-creator of Alan Partridge, all this stuff. And so we went for In the Loop.
This is the problem.
As our shared...
Yeah.
Our shared film, because something we saw at the cinema, we absolutely loved. It brings together the world of comedy and politics, both obviously we love so much. For me personally, being having The Sopranos is my absolute number one TV show of all time. James Gandolfini is in it.
Yeah.
What a legend.
Yeah. And I've been thinking about In the Loop a lot recently, because you know what is... In the Loop is the template for the most successful TV show of recent times, and that's Succession. It's the influence that...
I thought you were going to say This Government for a minute there.
Well, there's that too.
There's that.
But you can see into, because Succession is so funny for the same reasons that In the Loop is funny. In the Loop is slightly more farcical, I suppose, but it's a similar sort of style. And just love that kind of, everybody here is in a really serious job. They're all high paid, but no one knows what they're doing.
Yeah.
And they're just running around like headless chickens trying to defend themselves. And every motivation and every incentive in these people's worlds is the wrong one.
Yeah.
And it's so beautifully written.
Yeah. And what's beautiful is that it's, again, obviously after, say, obviously, that sounds like an arsehole thing to say, but what I mean
obviously,
Armando Iannucci went on to create Veep, which was the TV series that was sort of essentially the American, the thick of it. And in this, you know, this is the first amalgamation of British comedy and American, you know, for an American audience, that it's just wonderful to see like characters from the thick of it. Peter Capaldi, you know, not one angry Scotsman, but two, you know, the characters from that transplanted into America. Yeah. It was it's just a masterpiece.
The Capaldi Gandolfini conversation in the bar.
Yeah.
It's just beautiful, isn't it?
Have you ever even actually killed anybody? I mean, really?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, falling asleep on someone, that doesn't count.
It's wonderful.
Yeah. And it's I think it's like a lesson for comedy writers as well, if I can go a bit geeky about that. There's a lesson in juxtaposition of what of serious things and mundane or ridiculous things. So, you know, they're sitting in a room, the very, very senior people who are deciding whether there might be a war in which lots of people will die. And then they have to stop because the lady's teeth are bleeding.
Yeah.
So, you know, and their assistant's trying to sort of tell her that there's blood coming out of her mouth. It's so ridiculous.
But then, of course, there's the huge tonal shift by the end when it looks like war is going to happen. And I can't remember the actor's name, but Hugh, is he still Hugh in the Loop? It, basically, he's trying to stop it from happening. And it goes all of a sudden from really funny farce to an absolute heartbreaking tragedy. It's just such a film. It lived up to, we went in with high expectations.
Yeah, and Tom Hollander is just...
Oh, yeah.
Everything is funny about him.
Yeah. He makes a Bond.
Tom Hollander now, not Tom Holland.
Yeah, no, it's Tom Hollander. I think he'd make a good Bond. Yeah.
Oh, really? All right.
Yeah.
If Tom Holland,
I'm a bit old now, but I think he'd probably be quite a good one.
A good one. Tom Holland exists and Tom Hollander exists. Does that mean there's definitely also a Tom Hollandist? Like the most Hollandist of all.
Tom Hollanderer.
Yeah, Hondolera.
Have you thought about that? Would Timothy Chalamet make a good Bond?
No, to a feat.
No.
Right.
No.
No, he's about 5 years old.
Two-way fish. But in the loop, there's nothing negative. It's a fully five-star film.
Yeah. I think also because the thick of it was very quintessentially British. Yeah. And I don't think that would probably translate very well in the States. But in the loop, like you're saying, it bridges the gap. And I think that's what makes it so clever. that, and that's how I really wish Peter Capaldi had played Doctor Who. it would have been such a more interesting Doctor if he'd have, you know, been Malcolm Tucker on the TARDIS, you know, swearing at the console and, you know, annoying the Daleks. But no, that film, that In the Loop, is absolutely majestic. It absolutely is. I mean, I don't think I've ever met anybody who didn't like it.
No, it's hard to not like it. I mean, you could meet people who didn't get it.
Yeah.
I suppose. In the same way that some people don't like the thick of it, do they? And it's fine. Yes, some people just aren't involved in the political world enough to find it funny because they don't know who Alistair Campbell is, you know. So it's...
But the lovely thing about In the Loop is that it's that if you're a fan of the thick of it, you'll get loads from it. Yeah. But if you want to watch it as a standalone piece, you get it. Because some of the characters are different, then they're called different things, but it explains everything as it goes. It's just it's just incredible.
And Chris Addison's great in it, you know. Yeah. And there's the Succession. I mean, Gregory from Succession must be based on Toby's character from In the Loop, right? Mm. He's not called Toby in the Loop, is he?
No.
We'll marshal all the forces of darkness to hound you to an assisted suicide.
So In the Loop. So there you got your five choices. I normally say three. Yep. I'm used to that. So now we're going to move into your soundtrack. So which one of you would like to go first? Barry, going first?
Yeah, I'll happily go first because I mentioned earlier that I toyed with Into the Wild for the soundtrack. Yeah. The Eddie Vedder link, and it's a beautiful soundtrack. And then I thought, well, no, hang on. How can I cheekily get away with listening to lots of different artists? And I thought, one of the best soundtracks I've ever heard on a film that, you know, fits so beautifully with it was Vanilla Sky, the Tom Cruise remake. And I thought, rather than me try and remember them, I actually got the running order. I mean, listen to All the Right Friends, REM, Everything in Its Right Place, Radiohead, Salisbury Hill, Peter Gabriel, Africa Shocks, Last Goodbye, Jeff Buckley. I mean, Fourth Time Around, Bob Dylan, Chemical Brothers, Where Do I Begin? I remember watching and going, my God, this is tune. Not only is it a great film, it's tune after tune after tune. I love it. And it's loads of music that I love. So it's...
But you don't love Africa Shocks because you mentioned it was by Left Field or Africa Bambaataa.
Well, I didn't.
Interesting.
I didn't give the
you
artist.
You don't like that one, do you?
I do like tell. It. I
What's
do
wrong
like
with
it?
Hip hop?
Here we go.
tender thing in our office. But no, it's great. And then I get to listen to Jeff Buckley as well while I'm on the desert island because I can't think of another soundtrack he's on. I was like, the only way it would have been better is if I could have got Rufus Wainwright on a soundtrack. But I think the only song he's done for a soundtrack is he did Hallelujah on Shrek.
He's not in Moulin Rouge, is he, Rufus Wainwright?
No, I don't think so.
Mm-hmm. No. And might be like Calendar Girls or something like that, you know, one of those British films where they have
I love the music on Calendar Girls, though. To be fair, it was Gary Barlow and Tim Rice, wasn't it? And Dare, the song from that film was the big song, the single that they released was great. I thought, you know, it's Dare, do 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 do. Gorilla's joke, niche Gorilla's joke for everybody.
Everybody right now watches again. No.
Right. Look it up.
Oh, yeah, if you hang on, it's coming up. Yeah. If you'd done that, the preamble, I'd have gotten it.
Right, okay.
I just got it then. Yeah, it's
not that.
I'm on board with that joke now. I'm on board.
Yeah, you're on board. Well, at least one person's got it.
So Vanilla Sky. It's a mixture of songs.
Oh, okay. Vanilla Sky. Yes, choice. I'm not too sure about Radiohead on a desert island though. That's the only...
Would we be on this desert island together or separately?
No, you'd be together. Right. That's why you're picking films together and separately.
Yeah, we didn't think about that, did we?
It's an upbeat Radiohead one, though. It's not like...
Yeah, if there's such a thing.
Well, you need light and shade, don't you, on a desert island?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Sometimes you feel a bit, oh, I'm never going to get off this. Let's wallow. Let's get on Radiohead. Yeah.
Everything. Etc. I won't do the rest.
Do Africa Shocks.
No.
So come on, Paul, let's hear yours then. What are you taking with you?
I'm so sorry. I didn't take into account that we would both be on this desert island.
Oh, God, what have you done? James Bond.
Yeah. I've gone for my favourite Bond soundtrack.
No, that's all right. What have you gone for?
Okay. Do you think, you know what? What's your, do you know Bond soundtracks? What would be your favourite, Matt?
What a complete soundtrack? Because usually most people will just listen to the songs on a great sitcom.
I would say the best of Bond.
pretty good, I've got to say.
Which one's right?
Living Daylights. So yeah, and also License to Kill. I see. I'm quite partial to Timothy Dalton. I forgot to mention this earlier. I was a Roger Moore child Bond, yeah. Whatever. I don't know what you call it.
He was your Bond. Yeah.
Yeah, but Timothy Dalton was my. He was before his time.
I need to use your phone. Should call you back.
Who are you?
Bond, James Bond.
Me personally, for me, Timothy Dalton is probably, if I was nailed to a mast, I would probably say Timothy Dalton was my favourite Bond before his time. What Daniel Craig did was effectively what Timothy Dalton was doing, but with a posher voice. License to Kill, I love. I think I've even got the vinyl of Living Daylights and License to Kill somewhere in the house. So I possibly those two. I can't really remember.
I think we can probably be best friends now because I don't like saying who my favourite Bond is, but if I was absolutely pushed to, Timothy Dalton would probably be him.
Well, hang on, he was nailed to a mast. So if you nailed to a mast, what would you say?
Timothy Dalton. Well, ow, I'm nailed to a mast.
Yeah, that's what I'd
it's
say.
Timothy Dalton.
Call the police. But Timothy Dalton.
License to Kill is wonderful. I mean, some bits in it are a bit like, oh, really? You've done that? Okay, fine. And Living Daylights was a really good film, but it's such a shame he wasn't able to make a third.
So which is your soundtrack then?
My soundtrack is
Majesty's Secret Service.
It is on a Majesty's Secret Service. Finest Bond soundtrack of all. One of the reasons. We have all the time in the world. Louis Armstrong, the last song we recorded before he died. It was obviously because George Lazenby came in after Connery, which was a thankless task. And so John Barry, the co-creator, the co-writer of the Bond theme, and obviously the responsible for the Bond sound, really, decided to turn the Bond up to 11. So not only do we have All the Time in the World, the greatest love song ever written, we have the theme from On a Magic Secret Service, which is a belter. Then we have everything else is bonded up to the tits. So, and also the Bond theme played on a Moog, which has never happened before. And to top that, some of the most beautiful music to ever be committed to screen. There's a shot where, I mean, the film is beautifully shot, not to talk about the film again, which was the soundtrack, but the film is beautifully shot. There's a track on the soundtrack called Escape to Pit's Glory or Journey to Blofeld's Hideaway, it's called, which has got to be one of the most beautiful pieces of music ever committed to a film. It's incredible. It's like an instrumental version of We Have All the Time in the World. It's just beautiful.
Yeah, the incidental of All the Time in the World stuff is amazing. Oh. It fits so perfectly.
Oh, it's amazing. And then, of course, at the end, spoiler alert, Tracy gets killed by Blofeld. There's a lovely, haunting version of We Have All the Time in the World. And then, because they didn't want to send all the Bond fans out on a downbeat, an absolutely rip-roaring version of the Bond theme to finish it off. Mm. What a soundtrack.
I mean, for many, many years, On a Majesty's Secret Service was my favourite Bond film.
Yeah, I was going to choose it if it wasn't for me choosing the soundtrack.
Yeah, it's cracking. Everything. Yeah. Like I say, again, it's another really good one. But yeah, that's a great soundtrack. That is a great soundtrack. They're both great soundtracks, to be fair.
Is it a Bond film where Lazenby's fighting some guys on a beach at the start and the lady drives off in the car and he breaks the fourth wall, looks down the barrel and says, this never happened to the other fella.
Yeah, that's exactly the one. Yeah.
Right. So despite that, is it still a really good Bond
film? Despite that, that's the only bit where you're like, oh, really? Who thought that would be a good idea?
Right. Yeah, but I think that kind of, because I think it gave you that tonal shift from Connery. They had to do something to stop people going, he's not Sean Connery, is he?
Yeah. So I think you directly reference it. Yeah, fair enough. Yeah, you know,
that's very deliberate.
Yeah, so, fair enough.
And Ballas is Blofeld. I mean,
Pleasance is my Blofeld.
Kojak is a bad guy.
But I mean, he's a physical Blofeld, isn't he? So that's why he suits George Lazenby, whereas Donald Pleasance is a lot more. I think he's the best Blofeld. Donald Pleasance was excellent. Mm. With a big scar.
But also they used We Have All the Time in the World in the latest one, didn't they? No Time to Die.
Yeah. That was
a bit jarring for me when they did that.
Yeah. So when I watched No Time to Die, I initially really liked it. And then I've seen it a few times since. And now I like it a lot less. One thing I don't appreciate is
a lot fewer.
One thing I don't appreciate is the fact that We Have All the Time in the World is very specific. It's from the novel. It's about the love that the Bond and Tracy have. And it's about that. You can't, therefore, to my Bond nerd brain, pick that and plonk it in another film. Not only does it belong to a different character, a different James Bond, it's also, you can't use it as a love theme. It's like, it's Bond isn't a mashup.
Because it's a sad song, isn't it? So is it trying to recreate that from Majesty's Secret Service, yeah, but for Daniel Craig and Madeleine Swann?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's not about that. It's about Bond and Tracy. It's about the fact that they don't have all
time. I think, yeah, partly it was kind of because they kept homaging quite a few of the Bond films in that, but I also think it was foreshadowing the finale of the film. But I think that's what they were trying to do.
There's a lot of On Her Majesty's Secret Service. In fact, there's lots of Bond, a bit like Dying of the Day, which does it about as subtly as a train in your face.
That's not
references previous, but it references previous Bond films. So obviously, again, I'm using obviously. Sorry, Dying of the Day was 40th anniversary. They thought 40th anniversary, let's get as many Bond references as we can. So there's loads of those. There's loads of them in No Time to Die as well. Sometimes more subtly, but they directly reference We Have All the Time in the World. They directly reference the theme from On a Magic Secret Service as well. They use it. And so watching it a bit more objectively, it's a bit like, oh, why have you done that? Why have you done that? It's not a best of. Bond isn't a collage. make your own thing.
And on that bombshell, I've enjoyed being on this James Bond podcast.
I'm so sorry.
We have digressed twice. Yeah, that's really bad. I'll trim it all out.
Yeah, well, you've got all the time.
National Secret Service, right? And next week on the So anyway, so thanks a lot for coming on. We've got all your choices. Where can we see you next? When? And if you want to give us all your social media and everything, so I can.
Our live show is on Thursday nights, youtube.com/Larry and Paul/live.
9 p.m. GMT, 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time.
It's for LA
viewers. We do have some people who watch from there.
You're international.
Not many, but
you'll have viewers in Hollywood checking out what the English think of things.
Yeah.
So there
especially
we go.
Bond.
Facebook and Twitter and Instagram is all Larry and Paul.
No, because the Instagram is Larry and Paul Insta.
Yeah, but if you look for Larry and Paul, you'll find us.
Just find us on. Let's search Larry and Paul. We'll not far off.
Follow us on Twitter immediately and say hi there. I'm from Screen One, and then we'll say hi. Thanks for watching.
And indeed, everybody, thank you for watching. This has been Larry and Paul, and we will see you next time on Desert Island Movies. Bye.
See ya. Bye.